What's up guys, it's Vilatra, and today I am really short. And do you know why I'm very short? Well, it is because we are talking about the Reverie. Because I know many people are very confused about it, and I was actually confused. So I had to look up like what exactly happened again, you know, it's been a few years. So I compiled all of the relevant info that you should remember from Reverie, so that I can go over it in this video. So, oh, by the way, my hair's starting to get longer from the back now. It grows crazy quick, actually. Like, you wouldn't imagine. But yeah, I feel like this is... I'm using a different chair, you know. The other one was making my feet hurt a bit, so I decided to mix things up, right? I feel like that's a good thing to do sometimes, but yeah. So, to recap Reverie itself. It is the summit of the members of the world government. And it happens once every 4 years. It's like the elections, okay? Like all of the important guys come there and they vote on stuff. And it's a rule of the majority most of the time there. And a main topic of the Reverie was abolishing the warlords. So they are no longer in existence. Well, they exist still, they didn't disappear, but they are no longer warlords. They are just normal pirates. Really strong pirates, but pirates nonetheless. And the reason the government was ready to do that was because the Seraphim are there to replace them. And Fujitora as well was supporting this cause. Of course, along with the King of Alabasta and the King of Dressrosa. For obvious reasons, they are not very big fans of the shichibukai anymore. I wonder why. And while the kings were discussing there, the revolutionary army with all of the four commanders, Dragon and Sabo, I mean Dragon didn't go there, but Sabo and three of the commanders, I believe, like Lindbergh, Karasu, and Morley, those three went there and Bello Betty stayed with Dragon. I mean, they were first introduced, like they took down Peachbeard, and yeah, they were assembling to go and take on and declare war against the world government in order to get Kuma back. That was their main motivation. Because in Marizoa, they were using Kuma as a slave, as a prisoner basically, and they were making an example of him because he was a great king and a very imposing dude, but they were showing like even he is subject to the world government, and going against them meant demise for even someone as great as Kuma. And that's kind of their point there. So, when they infiltrated the Reverie summit, they actually attacked the admirals on off-screen, and they were able to wound Fujitora, but not Green Bull. And yeah, Green Bull and Fujitora were the only admirals present, because Kizaru and Akainu were at the HQ, and Garp left before they arrived, and Sengoku as well. Sengoku was at the headquarters, I mean. And we actually saw T-Bone, probably in like his final moments, because we found out that the Cross Guild got him killed recently. And he was talking with Akainu about how they were supposed to stop Fujitora, but he went anyway because it's technically not a military base. And Akainu wanted, or Sakazuki wanted Ryukyu, really hard name to say, but he wanted him to fight Fujitora, and Ryukyu actually, or Aramaki, actually declined. Interestingly enough, he was also not injured by the revolutionaries at all, while Fujitora was. And I mean, Garp left, so he wasn't because of that. I mean, it's possible that Ryukyu was escorting someone else out. And yeah, Fujitora was putting his fate into the Special Science Unit, Special Science Group, SSG. People were mentioning it a lot, but I don't know if that's a really relevant name anymore, but he was putting his fate into that instead of the shichibukai. And oh yeah, the revolutionaries, before they arrived, they actually inspired the Lulusia Kingdom to join them by defeating Peachbeard. And if you don't remember what the Lulusia Kingdom was exactly, it is the same kingdom that used the unknown super weapon or maybe devil fruit to completely eradicate. The setup is there, and now into the relevant events. So firstly, Saint Charles tried to kidnap Sirahosi, and he was stopped by another celestial dragon, Mjolskard. And it was mentioned that Mjolskard would be somehow punished by, like, the celestial dragon police. But I don't know how big of a punishment it was, because it could be always like, if he's more influential, I can see Mjolskard being more influential than Charles, and then in that case he probably wouldn't be punished that much. But if they have some extreme rules, maybe he was revoked his position as a celestial dragon to mirror his family mate, Don Quixote Homing, because Mjolskard is actually a part of the Don Quixote family. And because Saint Charles was trying to kidnap Sirahosi, Sai and Leo, they rushed in to like declare war, basically like, screw this, we are gonna save this guy. Which is a bit surprising, I wasn't expecting Sai to be like that. But yeah, they were stopped by Lucci, Kaku and Stasi, and the one masked CP0 guy as well. And they just beat up Leo. Come on, like, you're picking on a guy that's literally 15 centimeters tall, like, I don't know about this. And they also almost killed King Neptune because he was very mad. But yeah, this fight was stopped by Mjolskard stepping in. And I just want to mention how stupid Pell surviving was, because he shows up here and he's like, sorry, I wasn't here. I missed some stuff maybe. Sorry, I was guarding the king off screen. And like, I guess he was AFK, like he just missed everything happening, like, nice. Oh, that this is why you kept him alive, right? He's going to stop Uranus as well. He's going to get in the way and he's going to block it for everyone. That's going to be Bella's like final great sacrifice. Also, Sabo met his brother, or adoptive brother, King Selly of the Goa Kingdom. And Selly is a bit of a prick. Firstly, he's a raving racist, like extremely racist, okay? And he also wanted to become a celestial dragon, and he wanted to sit on the empty throne. So he's very much of a nothing person. And after Reverie, we saw that he escaped unharmed. He might come back into the story later, I feel like, but for now, he went back to Goa Kingdom, and he didn't die. I'm almost a bit surprised, because he's like the little kid getting in the way. Like, what if he was the one that walked into the empty room? Like, what would happen to him? We actually found out what happens if you enter the empty room, actually. And I feel like some people probably forgot this, so I'm going to mention it. Of course, because Kuma was being taken in as a slave, Bonnie tried to sneak in and save him. And she was using the Connie disguise, you know, turning herself into an old woman. And it's possible Connie is like her grandma or great-grandma. And yeah, Bonnie also did survive this, expectedly so perhaps. But she was thrown into the water. The Straw Hats somehow found her in the middle of the water, like swimming around. So she was literally probably thrown out of Marizoa, maybe using Kuma's power, like maybe he was given an order to throw out his own daughter, like that. Someone else that was there as well was Wapol, and he was able to get out of there alive. He was actually able to contact Morgans, and he was leaking some information to him. And also, something I wanted to mention is that Wapol has found a girlfriend, or a wife, I guess. And the wife has a laugh of a literal gold dig 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 dig. It's a gold digger in its purest form. And I mean, Wapol is probably the type of guy that does not care about that. He's not exactly after the substance, is he now? We also cut to Doflamingo in Impel Down 2 times. Firstly, an assassin might have been targeting him, because he knows about the hidden treasure of Marizoa, and it could be the thing that Im used to nuke Lulusia, it could be the giant straw hat, and it could be Im herself or himself. We do not know yet. And we don't really know much about Im. We don't even know if he or she can speak. But the Gorosei did ask him or her for their opinion about who should be erased next. And him, before he was speaking to them, he was looking at four people. He was looking at Luffy, Blackbeard, Shirahoshi, and Vivi. And he had sliced up Luffy, Blackbeard, and Shirahoshi, and he was holding a picture of Vivi. So, I think that kind of makes it clear that he wants to get rid of Luffy, Blackbeard, or Shirahoshi really, really badly. And Shirahoshi is of course an ancient weapon, and Luffy and Blackbeard, well, Luffy is the main character, Blackbeard is probably one of the main villains, I think it makes sense. And they are of course these as well. And from this discussion we actually know that the Gorosei are important. Even though Im is like calling the shots, the Gorosei are the ones executing it, and they are aware of what Im was doing with Lulusia as well. And I mean, we should have known that anyway, because one of them is also going to Egghead, and he wouldn't be going to Egghead if he was completely useless, would he now? But anyway, let me go into the confusing aftermath and the various dictates Oda was giving us. So, first, after the Fishmen and Garp left, something happened to King Cobra, and he was mentioning that he wanted to speak to the Gorosei when we saw him before, so it is possible he was murdered for that. And we also find out that there was an attempted murder on someone else that we are not completely clear on, and Vivi also went missing, and her location is unknown. The Straw Hats found about this through Morgans, because he really wanted to publish the news, and he didn't stop even though the world government wanted to silence him, so he has some integrity. The Straw Hats' reaction to this was quite mixed. Like, some of them wanted to go to Marizoa, Luffy wanted to go to Alabasta, and they really wanted to save Vivi, but they decided that, I mean, we can't do anything, let's just believe in her, hope that she's okay. You know, of course Vivi was like the 9th strongest female agent in the Baroque works, but that doesn't mean that she wouldn't be able to defeat these admirals and revolutionaries. I'm sure she's okay. And also, of course, Luffy doesn't think that Sabo killed King Cobra, because Sabo is being framed for it. And yeah, the kings abolished the shichibukai, and after that, King Cobra went to talk to the Gorosei. And Sabo was actually aware of this, and he saw this happening, and indeed, he did not kill King Cobra, it is very clear, and he says so. King Cobra entered the empty throne room where the Gorosei were, and he either saw Im-sama, or he was personally taken to him, and Sabo saw this happening, and Sabo saw Im there. So Im was revealed, and Sabo went into the hiding after he attacked. And they were able to free Kuma, but Kuma started running away again when Bonnie touched his memories. And after the battle, the revolutionaries seemed to have split up for a bit and went back to Kamabaga Kingdom. And Sabo ended up hiding on Lulusia, and he wasn't actually the main target. It was just a happenstance that he was over there as well, because the Gorosei mentioned that he was unlucky, but you know, that's fate, I guess. You know, he was taken out like that, you know, it is what it is. But of course Sabo wasn't taken out, but Lulusia Kingdom was destroyed by the super weapon Im has, possibly Uranus, we do not know. And he was on a ship there and trying to communicate with the dragon and the others. And now in the recent chapter, or the most recent chapter, 1082, we saw them discussing about what Sabo saw and revealing it to everyone. Also during the Reverie, 8 different kingdoms rebelled at once, and Lulusia was one of them. So the other 7 we are not aware of yet. The Reverie was super short, it was only like 4 chapters or something, but it had so many things happening in it. People were considering it its own arc, but I feel like it cannot be really considered an arc. It was more of a transitional set of chapters, like post-Wano or post-Dressrosa, or I mean, it literally was like post-Whole Cake Island, and it was setting up for Wano as well. and hyping up the possibility of rocks. And yeah, in Reverie we also found out about rocks as well, but that's not really something that happened in the Reverie. It's like, you know, info from the past. And they also revealed, technically in the Reverie, or at least the Marine HQ, they revealed the bounties of the Yanko and the shichibukai, but those were just public knowledge, so if I forgot something, just go ahead and tell me. Yeah, I probably should have remembered that Shanks rocked up. I mean, I wrote it into my notes, but I guess just I forgot to mention it. But yeah, Shanks was there, and he actually made a meeting with the Gorosei, just thanks to his influence alone. And he was there to discuss either about Luffy or Blackbeard, one of those two, for certain. And I wonder about what kind of connection he has to the Gorosei, that he's able to just rock up into Marichoa and they are just going to accept a meeting by him. Maybe he is so well respected that even the Gorosei are like, yeah, that's Shanks, we are going to talk to him. He's got a good head on his shoulders. There were also some talks about him being a snitch, but robot, that doesn't make any sense. I hope I helped you understand what is currently going on in the story of One Piece, because it is ever expanding and very vast. Bye bye everyone.